Well, let's turn to Romans 10. Now, again, much of the information in Romans 9 has been shared in a book that will one day come out if somebody will remind me to put together my articles in the thing. That will be called The God Who Hides Himself, or something like that. But it really does have some really good information, particularly Romans 9 and 11. So, let's see. I think I might even have these down. Let's just start at verse 1. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved, for I bear them witness that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. And I want you to notice that this is talking about faith and believing, because that's going to be the subject we'll be on for a little while. For Moses describeth the righteousness which is of the law, that the man who doeth those things shall live by them. Shall live by them. And this is an issue. This living by them, this is an issue, because it was an issue with the law, and it became the issue why the law came up in the first place. Okay, so I want you to think about that. I want you to think about the fact that the law came up in the first place in relationship to living by something. I mean, they said, okay, we'll do this. We'll live by this. We'll live. This was before the law. Just tell us what you want, and we'll live it. Okay? And so the one scripture out of all of the law and all of Moses that's quoted here is that the person that does the law, if you do one thing, then you have to live by it. Okay? You know, one verse that'll be quoted over and over and over again is Romans 1:17, but it's also in Galatians and Hebrews, same verse, same thing. The just shall live by faith. All right, so I would like to say that to God, faith has to do more with living. Okay, and we'll get into all of that, and you know, but I just want to emphasize that at this stage. Verse 6, but the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise, say not in thine heart, who shall ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down from above, or who shall descend into the deep, that is to bring up Christ again from the dead. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, is near thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. Okay. So there is the potential for living it right there, but there involves a faith that, quite frankly, is hardly ever referred to when people talk about faith. When people address the subject of faith, they don't get into this faith. And Romans does. So we will. Verse 9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus. Okay, so to confess the Lord Jesus, to confess the Savior Jesus doesn't necessarily require anything of us pertaining to how we live. Am I right? Ah, but to confess the Lord Jesus is a different situation. Confess the Lord Jesus and shall believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Okay, so The belief isn't that he saved you from your sins. The belief is that he is nigh thee, he's near thee. Here's how near. He's in your mouth, he's in your heart. This is the faith. This is the word of faith that we preach. That if you will confess, not that Jesus died for your sin. Isn't it interesting that you shall be saved if you have this faith, and this faith doesn't say anything about confessing your sins or him dying for your sins. Okay, so I guess we need to really think about that. I mean, we can't just sit in a class and hear that and let it pass, and then immediately, anytime we face any situation, allow ourselves to go back to only thinking in terms of, well, the only thing he requires is that Jesus died. And we have that, don't we? We have that in chapter 3, and we have that in chapter 4. It's not that it's devoid of the reality of it. It's not devoid of it. It is very much there. But the faith that he's expressing here and that he does set forth in chapter 3 and chapter 4, and really is the, and chapter 5 and chapter 6 and chapter 7 and chapter 8 are founded on, or the foundation, I mean, of chapter 10. In other words, it is the basis of what he's saying. He's not just talking, he's not just going, huh, well, let's talk about something different here. He's building, and that's what I want to do in this class, but there's no chalk. Pardon? I'm looking. Oh, isn't it cute? That's so cute. No, this is sufficient. I just didn't realize the dragon tooth was sitting back there. Oh, yes, that is my holder, by the way. I bought those, didn't I?
Yes, you did.
Was pretty sure I did. Somebody's been using my stuff. Okay, so we're talking about building, and the Apostle Paul talks about building, and he's a builder. I mean, he is. You can read that in Corinthians. You read his way that he presents that, you know, that he's building on the foundation, or that others build on that foundation, that he's laying that foundation. And so we're going to be talking about faith. Boy, it's feast or famine around here. I got the big one over here. I got the dragon tooth there. And I got the little guy, ladybug. Yeah, ladybug. Cute. Okay, so, you know, we say we're going to talk about faith. And we need to, because we actually skipped over a portion in chapter 3 and chapter 4. But then he's coming back and he's hitting it further in chapter 10. So what better time to do this? Whereas if we hadn't have continued this course, there would have been a study of the book of Romans without any kind of real study of faith. And how crazy is that? Okay. So faith, and that's a building block. And I'm going to present this a little different to you. We're going to build, but this word faith is going to be our empty block, because we call it faith, but we don't really understand the full progression of faith or how this thing builds. And if we don't, I do believe that we can, it can bear witness in our spirit what God has done, but we couldn't explain it, and we wouldn't even know some of the main things that are the foundation of it. So we're going to discuss, we're going to start doing some building blocks here, and I'll do it. First we'll just put the building blocks down, and then hopefully from that we can see how it builds into a building or whatever. We'll also discuss some of the things that faith is not, and we're going to discuss a very simple presentation of what God expects in relationship to faith. a simple prison. We're not going to get into the big stuff of that. Anyway, so that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. That's interesting. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. Who was that? Me and Mike Gentry were talking about that. We were talking about, he said something like, yeah, when we get to heaven, you know, it's not going to be any Jews or Greeks. I said, I bet the Irish are glad they're going to be there then. it's just the Jews and Greeks who's not going to make it. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And let me just check. Okay, verse 16. But they have not all obeyed the gospel, for Isaiah saith, Lord, who hath believed our report? That's Isaiah 53. And that's not just the report of identification or substitution. It's the report of him and whom we believe. I don't know. Okay, the Lamb. All right. Because the Lamb is the Lord on the throne, amen? And confess the Lord Jesus, which is to confess the Lamb. Anyway, we don't want to get into too much of that right now. And then verse 17. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. All right? So we all know that scripture, and you also, most of you know my little thing is that faith doesn't come by the word of God. Faith comes by hearing. Hearing comes by the word of God. And if you don't have hearing, you're not going to have faith. Faith cometh by hearing. Okay. But you're not going to have hearing unless you're in the Word of God. All right. So I want to just do some reading. I'm going to, Lord willing, start to try to make some, I mean, we've got a long way to go here. You know, we really did. Bless you. So here we go. What we've covered thus far in the book of Romans is to see this book in light of the ancient paths of God. Can I get amen on that one? That, I mean, is it? We have seen the meaning of Romans wrapped within the framework of the Day of Atonement and the captivity of Judah in Babylon. Now it is time, while retaining those images, to examine the book as the light from which those other events drew their form. To see Romans as the light from which they drew their form. To examine truth wrapped in story form, such as the Day of Atonement or the captivity, can give dimension to pure doctrinal truth. That has been our approach thus far, but as we examine the doctrinal sections of Romans, the ones that we're entering into now, we must not only understand the stories, but the actual flow of the order of God's words written in them. What I'm referring to there is the building blocks. You need to start setting your heart and your mind and your being to say, Holy Spirit, help me understand. I wrote it the flow of the words, but it's not just the words. It is the building blocks that we're going to lay out that if you can grasp, it will be a foundation in you, whereas stories won't. Because it is the foundation, and it is what's real. So I'm going to read that last sentence again. But as we examine the doctrinal sections of Romans, we must not only understand the stories, but the actual flow of the order of God's words written there. The flow of the order of God's words. The flow of the order of how we can build an image of faith that is acceptable to God and not an idol. Acceptable to God. For without faith, it's impossible to please God. You almost have to have a bride heart from the very beginning, because it has to be about pleasing God, not, oh, I got to get faith, or I want to be a powerful man or woman of God. You understand what I'm saying? It's about pleasing God. But if you start from the wrong premise, then you're already off. You know, you're already off. It's about God pleasing you by giving you gifts or whatever. God set forth the order of these chapters in a precise manner. Our task during this portion of our study is to grasp that flow as it moves from one idea to another, building as it goes. The end result will not merely be that we have our doctrinal ducks in order, but that we begin to comprehend with all saints what is the length and the breadth and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ that passeth knowledge. Okay. And that's Paul in Ephesians saying that. I actually wrote it down and then looked back at the scripture and never changed it, but I think the breadth comes before the length and whatever, but that's the scripture, that's the idea. It is to not be satisfied to know what we call simple salvation and simple faith and simple this and simple that, but to know the length and the breadth and the height and the depth of Christ. I mean, I wouldn't sit in these classes if I thought they were just going to be about doctrinal junk. You know? I mean, I want Jesus. And since I can't sit in the class, and that's in my own class, as I pondered not teaching this semester and all of the wonderful time I would get in the Word, I realized that one of the things that makes it real for me is that I get to pour out what I get to take what He's given me and to give it, and not just gather and hoard in my little upstairs prison. And if, is He precious? You know, am I a leper and have I not found great treasure? Anybody know what I'm talking about, the scripture? You know, and if I am, like the three lepers said, one of them said, we can't do this, man. I don't think that's the exact wording, but it's like, we can't do this, man. We cannot do this. We cannot just sit here and enjoy this and not tell people in there that are starving and dying and whatever. And I know that we can't either. You know, I know that we can't. But, you know, how shall they hear lest a preacher preach, you know? And faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word. And the just shall live by faith. And so there's a calling to our hearts, not to our ministry. And it is our place to be able to discern that calling and respond properly to the Lord and to the Spirit, and to say, and to sit in these classes and to say, Holy Spirit, I'm in your class. And I did that in Bible school. I did it at a certain juncture. He won me over in certain things. And I said, I am not just in this class. I am in your class. And Jesus told me, you're my teacher. And you're going to teach me. I know that you will, because Jesus said you would. You know, I used to talk to Him like that a lot. And yes, I still do. But, you know, I mean, the Word of God says, Jesus told us, you're going to teach me. And I know that one of the requirements is that I be open to you. But guess what? How do you be open to the Holy Spirit in a proper way? Do you just say, okay, Holy Spirit, come do it. Do something big. Show me something, you know? Or do you say to the Holy Spirit the most powerful thing that you could say to Him to get Him to move? You say to Him, Holy Spirit, I love Jesus so much. And I really want to know him. And I know that without you, I am totally an idiot. And even with you, I am. So you're going to have to put this in me. You're going to have to show me how beautiful he is and how wonderful. And he just loves Jesus. And he goes, okay. Okay, you're the worst person I could have chose for this, but okay. I know, you're the, okay, you know, you got me, you know, you roped me into this one, but he's faithful. He's faithful to Jesus. You see that? He's faithful to Jesus. And he can't resist a heart, you know, that loves Jesus, and that's the goal, you know. Because, see, since he doesn't speak of himself, when you start saying, oh, it's about Jesus, he goes, that's good, because to me, too, it's about Jesus. So we're on the right track here. So that's you know, the approach of our heart is incredibly important. And that's, you know, and that was one of the reasons why that scripture that was shared, that Jacob, you know, sleeping on a hard ground and pillow as a rock and all of this, and running in fear from his brother and sad because of the separation between his mom and his dad and his home and everything he ever knew. And at that moment, that is not open. He's only caught up in his own circumstances. Does that make sense? I mean, in that we do that, and therefore we don't know the Lord's in this place, you know, because we can't perceive it because we're somewhere else, you know. And if the Lord is in that place, we wouldn't know it because we're not there. We're off in our mind caverns, you know. And so God gives him a dream, and he wakes up and he says, surely the Lord was in this place, and I knew it not. He was here. He's here. He's actually here. Even in the worst of places, he's really there. And we can find the Lord. We can, you know. It was that me and Lindsay, I think, were talking about that. And I'm going to be sharing on Sunday, and we'll eventually get to some of the same points that I'm talking about right now, and that is, it doesn't matter what your earthly environment is. You have to be responsible to make an environment for the Lord. Amen. And you go, well, you know, Brother Randy ought to be more spiritual. God knows, you know. God knows. But ultimately, our own hearts, we have to be tender. And so that's why I spend so much time stopping from teaching and talking about being tender and making sure our focus is the Lord, and always looking to the Holy Spirit, because these are eternal keys. They will always be true, even when it's all over with and there's no more sickness and no more demons and no more this and that. It'll still be the key. It's eternal. So that's why I do it. And the other reason why I do it is because, if nothing else, to keep my heart tender. I don't, you know, I just, God help me, I don't want to get to a place where I think I know something and I'm not with my heart desiring to be closer to Jesus. You know, I just... And y'all pray, you know, if you pray for me, that's what you ought to pray, because I, part of what it, you should pray. All right. So our study at this time will be to grasp Paul's concept of what the faith involves. So we're going to be referring to two concepts in relationship to faith. And that, I know you're coming in quietly and not wanting to be seen, but how did it go? Did it go good? Good, yeah. Mike told me y'all were doing it tonight. So I guess Jim ought to be coming in soon. We're going to be talking about two things. They're really one, but they're two. The faith and faith. The faith and faith. Okay. The faith is what we believe. What we hold. And when I say what we believe, you know. You know the word lie is in the middle of believe? It is. I've, you know. And it is what we hold as sacred in the Lord, or what we hold as truth that transforms, or light that transforms. It's not just doctrine. It's not just a set of doctrines. Okay. So it's important as we go for you to register right now tonight this difference between the faith and then the just shall live by faith, not the faith, but faith. Okay. Living is the activity of the faith becoming real in us and moving and motivating us. All right. So our study at this time will be to grasp Paul's concept of what the faith involves and then to see how that works out in exercising faith on a daily basis. And again, when I say exercising faith, I don't mean I have a faith in me and I'm going to believe for this or that. I mean how the faith has captured us and transformed our life, therefore our walk. Okay. So you might want to jot this down just to remember this. It's three scriptures: Romans 1:17, Galatians 3:11, and Hebrews 10:38. All right, in the mouth of two or three witnesses, we have the just shall live by faith in those scriptures. Okay, mouth of two or three witnesses, we have the just shall live by faith. Now, why would one little phrase like that in what, Habakkuk? One little phrase like that be used three times in the New Testament? Well, because it is a cornerstone. It is a cornerstone. Faith was a lifesaver for Habakkuk. Okay. So, I mean, the man was messed up. He was messed up. And it got so bad he was blaming God because of what? His circumstances, because of his environment, because of the way things were going. Apparently, they weren't going the way that he thought they were should go. And part of the whole situation of Habakkuk was that he didn't understand God. He was a prophet. He had a good understanding of Scripture, and he had a good understanding of the Jewish view of things, but he didn't understand God, and it was rough on him because, as we'll show, drop down here and show, it wasn't the kind of faith God was looking for. But, oh, man, what a precious brother in the end when he gets hold of the Lord and he's just with the Lord, man. He's just, you know, whether everything's blooming or it doesn't matter to him anymore. He's just with the Lord. So don't you believe you can be with the Lord in an environment while your external environment is hell? Some of you are going, yeah, I'm doing it right now. It's called new creation. But here's the difference. A lot of times we are when we're good or we're doing good, we're able to be with the Lord when everything's going bad around us. And that's pretty amazing. But that's not ultimately what Habakkuk did or the faith. The faith can see God in those bad situations. It doesn't just go, oh, it's bad, but I'm going to be with the Lord. It sees the Lord in it. You know, his big complaint was it Nebuchadnezzar and, you know, the coming down and doing horrible things to the precious people of God? And how can you do this? And I thought God was just and da-da-da-da. I wouldn't plan on getting off on all this, but if you really want to hear the real story, I'll share it on it somewhere. And it's good, isn't it?
Yes.
It is just tremendous. And what he begins to see is, you know what? God is really cool. He's not like what I thought he was, and he's actually in control. You know? I mean, oh, I've got, yes, Holy Spirit, I can't go as fast as you. God. I'm sorry, I can't. All right, so let's begin. Amen. So let's begin to first show what faith is not. All right, so we're going to go down and below faith. Now, why is it important? If, you know, well, let's just get to the subject. We don't need to know what it's not. Well, we do if some people think that what it's not is faith. You know. So you have to debunk that which is not the Lord in this case so that we may find the Lord in truth. All right. Most of these blocks are in small portions, small tidbits. They're not huge. What faith is not? In the New Testament, we're told to have faith. But the faith that we are to have is not merely faith in God. Now, there's the rest of the sentence here, but I want you to maybe really grasp that the faith God is calling for is not just faith in God. Or faith that there is a God. Okay, so we say, okay, so here's this atheist, and I don't believe there's a God. There ain't no God. You know, when we die, we just die. It's over with. If there's a God, things would be better than this. There ain't no God. All right? So then, all of a sudden, one day, he starts believing there's a God. I didn't say he got saved or asked Jesus in his heart. He just goes, you know what? I saw a sunrise once, and you know, and a bass jumped in the lake in front of the sun, and you know, beautiful swans or whatever went floating by, and I know there's a God. Big deal. So does the devil. Okay. So it's important to understand that in the New Testament, the faith is not believing that there's a God. The Jews believed that there was a God, and they totally missed Jesus. Amen? Okay. So we need to settle that right away. I mean, we're not trying to convert people to believe there's a God. I mean, in fact, there's tons of people who believe there's a God, and they don't even think it's Jesus. I believe in God. You say, do you believe in God? Yeah, I believe in God. Okay, I'll leave you alone. You know, let me witness to somebody who needs God. Oh, by the way, what God do you believe in? Satan. Oh, okay. But the faith that we're to have is not merely faith in God as the Jews understood it, as if it is faith that there is a God. Faith is not just believing there is a God or even the correct God. Many Jews had that. They had the correct God and were not saved. In fact, he says it right here in Romans 10, that they might be saved. Verse 1, brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. And then he starts talking about faith. The Jews believed in God in that manner, but didn't recognize Jesus when he came among them. The devil believes there's a God and trembles. That's what the scripture says. The devil not only believes, but he trembles. There's a God. See, we say, I believe there's a God, and we don't tremble. And trembles, but that belief does not save the devil. We may believe in God, believe in his miracles, power, deliverance, yet Hebrews 3 says that they who believed in a God who did these things were yet in unbelief in other areas of importance, which counted to God, which were the ones that counted when it comes to faith and finding out what faith is to God. See, we just go, well, the faith, the preacher says, faith is believe that, you know, there's a God and Jesus died for your sins and that's it. Okay, well, that's exactly just wonderful. If that's, which we'll get into just in a second, if that's exactly what God's looking for, but if it's not, don't try to pawn that off to God as what he wants, because he knows what he wants. Amen? You know, and so it always goes back to the heart again. What do you want, Lord? Without faith, it's impossible to please God. Then what is the faith that you want? Well, one that pleases me, first of all. Can you see that? So we go back to, what is it that you want? How may I please you by knowing you correctly? And that's the next one that I'll deal with, called faith as prescribed by God. One more sentence here. Faith is not just first found as complete trust and confidence in God in general. All right. So can y'all please hold on to that forever? Yeah. Faith is not found as complete trust and confidence in God in general. Because, again, you know, the Jews believed in a God in general, and Paul's praying that they might be saved. All right, so faith as prescribed by God. So we will, the building blocks are going to go out this direction for you to the right, but we're going to put another one down here. Right now, I'm just going to label it idols. Faith is prescribed by God. I think I've addressed this maybe recently in one of these classes. One of the primary requirements of faith is that we relate to God in a manner prescribed by him. Okay, so faith, folks, is relating to God. Hallelujah. Okay, but not just because everybody relates to God. I mean, even if it's in a bad way, they're relating to God, you know. They flaunt stuff in his face and stuff. So it can't just be relating to God. It is relating to God in a prescribed way, the way that is prescribed by him. I'll read it again. One of the primary requirements of faith is that we relate to God in a manner prescribed by him. All right. Therefore, idolatry is that of relating to God in a manner not prescribed by him. Okay, so what, was it okay when Israel was brought out by the true and living God, but at a certain juncture when Moses was gone for a while and wasn't standing around making sure that everything they did, you know, hey, stop that and do this, and you know, that's the law. Moses represents the law. And when the law was, you know, when Moses was not standing over them and looking, they go build a golden calf, which Aaron, who was the initiator of the whole thing, said, we didn't build it. We just kind of threw it in the fire, and this is what came out. That's what he said. You know, it's like, I don't know, you know. Geez, we're trying. Yeah, you're very trying. Okay, so therefore, idolatry is that of relating to God in a manner not prescribed by him. All right, so we would say, well, a golden calf, that's horrible. But what if we're relating to God in a different manner than what's prescribed by him? Isn't that the same exact thing in the sense that it's just something else? Whether it's wood or gold or pizza or I don't care what, whatever it is, that's not him. And he's going, you're not relating to me. It's almost like somebody standing in front of him and talking around him, like looking past him, you know, and said, I'm relating to Jesus, you know. And he's going, you don't even see me, and I'm right there. You're looking right past. You're looking at what you've formed probably within you, within your own mind, the desires of your heart, and you've formed God after your image. And, you know, we all know these things. We dealt with that in the second chapter of Romans. Instead of saying, you know, my doctrine is not my own, I don't even know what to believe unless you show me and tell me, and then my doctrine will be yours, not mine. And we say, but if we do it that way, there's going to be things that we don't like about him. Or not things we don't like about him, I'm sorry. There'll be things that we don't like. Yeah. Well, I mean, the first question isn't, you know, what you like or don't like. The first question is, from whence cometh that don't like? It's your flesh. Your flesh is the source. And, you know, you're going to just say, okay, I'm going to let my flesh reign. And people do it all the time, and I understand that, but doggone it, I don't want to do it, and I believe there's people here that don't want to do it, and that the Lord is more precious than gold or silver, gold, a golden idol. I mean, it's interesting that the Lord constantly said, do not make any graven image of me. Why did he do that? He said, because you don't know me. You don't know me. You have to spend time with me. You have to see me in action. You know, the Lord, you know, you do learn much by seeing the Lord in action. You know, I mean, I always relate back to a time period where when the great rock band was playing and I had this guitar. Do y'all remember the name of it? The Jesus is Lord Hondo. It was a Hondo. And somebody who gave it to me, it said Jesus is Lord on it. So we called it the Jesus is Lord Hondo. And it was like a Les Paul, but it was like, you know, a Hondo. It was an abomination to God. So, you know, and we were at some gig, and there was a band that played, and afterwards when we played, they just mocked me and my Jesus is Lord Hondo. I mean, I went running out crying like a sissy. No, I didn't. No, the exact opposite actually started happening. There was something called Oak Cliff started rising. Anyway, So, you know, I went into this thing, man, you know, God, come on, what is the deal? Why would you, you know, you know, you go through stuff, you know, and I was thinking, you know, this is terrible. You know, here's all the junk. Anybody ever heard this? I represent you. and all of that junk. Oh, it just, you know, it's embarrassing to even talk about, but it's the truth. It's the truth, and you know, and I really went through it. You know, it's like, every time we got ready to play, I pull it out and go, Lord. Anyway, one day, you know, the Holy Spirit was able to sit me down and say, now, rebellious young flesh pile, you quivering pile of flesh, I'd like to talk to you. And he began to explain that that was given of God. And that how could I treat the Most High? And I know we're deeper now, but I mean, that was my Jesus he was talking about. And somehow I didn't, you know, I wasn't relating it like that. And I just saw this, that I was ashamed of the Lord. I mean, ultimately, I was ashamed of the Lord. And it broke my heart. And I tell you what, after that, I loved that guitar. I loved it. I started doing the unthinkable. I started polishing it, you know. And I was just coming out of that bad spirit and coming into the new, not fully out, but not fully in. And Adrian walks up and gives me a American-made Telecaster. Not this one, but an American-made, full-on, blown, top-notch Telecaster. And it was like, Lord, this is the worst thing you could do to me, to be nice back to me during this time. This is, don't do this, please. I can't take this, not this. And it just melted my heart. And I, you know, and that's where you get to know the Lord. You know what I mean? You get to know that, you know, love is stronger than death and all that kind of stuff. And you just see what he's really like, and you know, which is a great thing if you're an abuser in that like situation, because then you can abuse him all the time because you know he'll, you know what I'm saying? But the beauty of it to him is that not everyone will do that, and the ones that don't will love him more than they did before, you know. All right, so to know him requires experience and not just Bible study. Amen? Okay. So, therefore, idolatry is that of relating to God in a manner not prescribed by him. There are many who are Christian in creed, but live a life not properly oriented to God. Now, I'm sure we're thinking of some denomination or some person that's Christian, but they're, you know, they're doing drugs or they're, you know, doing this or that or whatever, you know. And we're going, yeah, that's who Randy's talking about when he wrote that. No, I'm talking about it could be anybody in this room that we believe the creeds of the Lord, but we are not properly oriented to him as he desires. Therefore, anything that we call faith is not faith, because it's faith in something that's not him. Okay. Even if we are aimed, I put it in parentheses, aimed at the true God, because the Jews were aimed at the true God in their belief systems. Even if we are aimed at the true God, if our actions are not in accord with the relationship prescribed by him, then, in a sense, we worship something that is not God, i.e., idolatry. Idolatry. Okay. So, can you see how important it is to grasp, as we lay these building blocks, not to grasp concepts? God help us, because we still won't have it. We will miss him again. But to grasp what is his heart, what is his way, which is all based with him, all of this stuff is based on his makeup, his substance, who he is. You see, he's not just like, well, I'm one way, but I have certain concepts, you know. Do you understand what I mean? You know, what he is and what he does are the same. Yes. There is no breakdown. And I know that's hard for humans to grasp, but God is so totally that way. And that can be a stable thing for you eventually. In one way, it can stabilize you, because when you run into teaching that you don't understand, but you have been beginning to understand the Lord, you can refer back to him, the being of him, and not just try to get him to talk to you about explanations of things. You know, this, Lord, this came out from you. Therefore, this must be some aspect of you that I don't quite have together. Help me to know you. Help me to know you. Then you got the Holy Spirit again on your side, see? You put yourself in the best possible situation because you're not after creeds and explanations. You're after the Lord. Yes. It's not a head hunger. Because there's a head hunger. You know, it's a hunger for knowledge. I mean, and it's, you know, but it's not necessarily the Lord. I had it in Bible school. Man, I devoured books, and I still read books. I, you know, as much as I get a chance, I do. And I enjoy reading. I used to hate it till I had a revelation of Christ. I don't mean saved. I mean a revelation of Christ. I hated reading. I love reading. But at a certain juncture, the Lord told me, you have a hunger, but it's not for me. It's for knowledge. And I had to face that. You know, the Lord sometimes makes you face stuff that you don't want to face. And I had to face that, and I went, oh, my God, you know, it's just tough. This stuff's tough sometimes. But it's good. Ultimately, it leads, you know, the truth is the light, and it'll... So ultimately, it's good, or more importantly, ultimately, it's God. And we can say ultimately, it's of God, but then the ultimate of that is it literally becomes God. You become more one with what he is instead of knowledgeable of the scriptures and of the various theological teachings on in Christ, Christ in you, the cross, da-da-da-da. You no longer hug those things or love them like you did, because the way that you saw them were separate from him. Now you hug only Christ. That means if an angel from heaven, isn't that what Paul said? He didn't say from hell. If an angel from heaven preach any other gospel than Christ crucified, then let it be accursed. Okay, well, that's a pretty hard stand. That's a glorious stand. Because Paul, that's why he wrote most of the New Testament, because he's not going to settle. Everybody else might. He's not going to settle. He's not going to do it. He loves Jesus. He wants Jesus. He knows that to seek Jesus in a true way is going to... The crooked will be made straight, and the highs will be brought down, and the lows will be raised up, and it's going to devastate your life as far as your life, but you didn't want your life anyway if you really loved him. So you say, this is what I want. This is my desire. You ever hear songs that are like that? This is my desire, and it's pointed at him. So, and here's, you know, I mean, we're about to quit, but teachers or an environment like this can help keep you pointed in the right direction. Do you believe that? But the real need is a compass inside of you that will only point to Jesus. And no matter how hard it gets hit and spins around, it'll always come back to true Jesus, true north, true Jesus. It'll always come back to that. And so, and the only way to know that if you really have that compass is to get hit enough times. Well, it's the truth. I mean, this is how I learned it. Just good old-fashioned experience to get hit, watch it spin, because, you know, I remember when I was in Bible school, some preacher would come in from another place, and he'd be teaching prosperity or something, you know, and I'm listening to that. Or I remember one guy, I remember the exact situation, was one guy came in, and I mean, he was really legalistic. I mean, really legalistic. And I was just a young Bible school student with long hair. Oh, yeah, I'm still got long hair. Anyway, I started getting under condemnation. And I mean, it was really, really affecting me. It was moving me off of Christ and Him crucified. And so much so that it was, you know, it brought me under condemnation and said, you should be, you know, toeing the line with the law. It didn't say the law. It just said toeing the line, doing this and that and da, 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 da. And so I went back to my dorm room and I cried out and I sought the Lord. And the next day I was in a class and one of the teachers taught something, and it just showed Jesus was where I wanted my compass to point, but depending on where I got hit, it could end up pointing any number of directions. Amen?
Yes.
You know, I mean, it's great to be in an environment, but if you really don't have that compass in you, it's like the city of refuge. You better not go outside of it. Because somebody's going to say something contrary to that, and you're going to, oh, my God, maybe they're right. And I know, and I'm telling you, when I saw that, I literally saw it, and I saw the workings of this other in me, and like, you know, I just went, oh, my God, I can't be this way. You know, I mean, I never, you know, my heart was, you know, when I turned to the Lord, my friend said, well, what are you going to do? I said, I'm going to follow Jesus. Well, when I got ready to graduate Bible school, what are you going to do? You know, they all have their idea. Well, what that means. What are you going to do? I said, I'm going to follow Jesus. Well, what do you get? You know, everything began to be about Jesus and not, you know, the expectations of the world. And as time went on and things got challenged, my compass got stronger and stronger and stronger. And I tell you what, I know it. I'm a messed up person, but I got a compass. I do. I have a very real compass. And anybody that really knows me knows how incredibly strong it is. I will not back off from the Lord or leave the Lord or go or allow certain things that if I believe that that's going to, I just won't. I just, the Lord is too precious to me, and what I was nothing, and He took nothing, and then He put something inside of me called a treasure, and He's a treasure to me, in me, to me. He's a treasure, and He's been a treasure. He's going to be a treasure. He's not just Jesus in my heart and all that. Nothing but theological explanation of something that makes us feel spiritual. But he's a treasure. That's a treasure. And I cannot compromise that treasure. Anyway. All right. So we're going to stop and take a break.